My name is Chris Packham. I'm a broadcaster, naturalist and environmental campaigner in the UK, and recently I was forced to take a libel case in the High Court. And central to that case was circus animal welfare, particularly that of tigers. So I called upon veterinary professor of animal welfare, Andrew Knight, and lecturer Emily Davis to conduct a review of the literature to see if we could show that tigers' welfare is compromised in travelling circuses. And here is what they found.
For me personally, I was so interested in doing this research because I love animals and I want to be able to further their research. But it goes beyond just the individual. It's trying to change policy. And we see time and time again that policy only changes if there's evidence to warrant that. We're lacking in terms of the scientific research behind this area because there's just not much in terms of research on circus welfare at all. Our systematic reviews shown that. So I think for me personally, pulling together all of the various aspects of what is available within research helps to identify where some of those gaps are, where we still need to do more research, and hopefully that can push the field forward to ultimately change policy and stop wild animals in circuses going forward.
Animal welfare is a relatively new science. It's been rapidly developing in recent years, and today it's considered to consist of five domains, which are the domains of nutrition, physical environment, behavioural interactions, healthcare, and also mental state. And to consider information about all these different areas in helping inform a view of whether the animal overall has good or bad welfare. We conducted a systematic review, which is a sort of a best practice way to look at all of the scientific literature and make sure you haven't missed any important scientific studies. And by doing this, we were able to identify 42 scientific studies looking at all the different aspects of welfare, more than half of which were from the last decade and all of which were relating to tigers. So we had a really strong body of scientific evidence telling us about the welfare of tigers in circuses. With respect to nutrition, for example, tigers would naturally consume animals such as chitals, sambas and other grazing animals from the savannas of India. The correct sort of diet for tigers in captivity really should consist of animals such as horses, cows, chickens, other animals that fairly well approximate the nutritional needs of tigers. The trouble with travelling circuses is that the types of meat available to them vary quite significantly as they travel around our countryside, so it's much more difficult to maintain nutritional soundness and also consistency over time. The second domain relates to physical environment. The trouble with the housing of tigers within circuses is that the amount of physical space they have tends to be extremely small, even compared to tigers in zoos. According to one of the studies we looked at that surveyed a large number of these enclosures, the amount of space is around about a quarter of the space available to tigers in zoo settings. The natural range of a tiger is about 50 square kilometres per day. Compare that to the enclosure of a fairly unenriched exercise pens in which circus tigers spend most of their time. That causes chronic stress for tigers, which we see in terms of things like repetitive, apparently purposeless behaviours, which are believed to indicate stress, which is both chronic and also quite profound. So these are really common in captive carnivores, particularly tigers, in circuses. These tigers are being exposed to changes in noise, smells, sounds, sights. They often don't have visual barriers to retreat behind. They may be transported with other animals that they wouldn't naturally choose to be in close proximity to. This is all very stressful for tigers.
The only domain where we see divisiveness in the scientific literature is the behavioural interactions domain, and that's based on training. There's an opportunity for it to be a really positive interaction if the human and animal relationship is one that's built over time and it's built on very positive interactions such as positive reinforcement training. If this is a negative behavioural interaction, it's going to cause negative welfare implications as well. And so we see with performances that these are going to be negative. They're not using the same performers. They have a whole audience of people that are different every night. There's loud sounds and bright lights. Overall, that's going to be a negative environment.
Another key domain for the welfare of these animals is the health domain. And a key concern in this is a lack of appropriate veterinary care. The number of zoo health specialists worldwide by 2023 was less than 75. In a country, for example, like Spain, that would be less than 0.01% of all veterinarians in the country. There are very few specialist zoo health veterinarians worldwide, and other veterinarians have very limited knowledge and ability to deal with tiger healthcare problems and injuries as well. Unfortunately, the case records of the tigers from circuses that I've examined have involved really disturbing things such as prior fractures, which were not appropriately set and treated at the time, resulting in chronic lameness and ongoing pain. Other concerns are things like declawing surgeries, where actually the end of the toes are amputated at the final joint, and this is done to remove the sharp claws on the innervose togas, which increases safety for the handlers and trainers. However, it's a completely inappropriate way of trying to address safety concerns. There are much better and more humane ways to do that, and it does tend to result in chronic pain for these animals. One of the case records that I looked at showed actually curvature of the spine, which indicates that this tiger had been in so much pain over such a long period of time and making such an effort to not put weight on the painful paw that the spine had actually curved, indicating a very long-term and very serious problem.
When we're thinking about the mental state domain, we're looking to identify negative welfare indicators and positive welfare indicators. There are many different ways of doing this. We can look at different hormones, such as stress hormones like cortisol, and identify the levels of those hormones within the individual. But we can also look at their behaviours. So there's some indicators that are associated with negative welfare, and that can be things such as stereotypic pacing, it can be excessive grooming, and it can even be avoidance behaviour, such as retreating to hides, that sort of thing. Then you've got positive welfare indicators such as foraging and sleeping and walking in a more natural way, and that's all dependent on the head positioning and various other aspects. We identify these using ethograms, and then we can create activity budgets, and then we can look to see how much of the activity budget is full of negative welfare indicators versus positive ones.
It's essential, now that we've got some good science, that we act upon it. We should be driving for policy change. So first up, read the paper, click on the link below, and secondly, visit the website of AAP and make sure you join in with some of their effective campaigning work in Europe.